Hi, this is Annie Dance. I am an investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in North Carolina. Today, Wednesday, May 1st, 2024, we will see what the North Carolina General Assembly is up to with today at the NCGA. There's many things on the agenda, and so let's get started with the Session Rules Committee.
Lisa Barnes, Senator Barnes.
Thank you, committee chairman. Yes, I've been selected to explain all four of the bills, which they all do the same thing, very technical in nature, and simply adjust the board staggers to shorten the terms to correct the staggers, because current law does not allow these boards in different regions. So I know of no opposition and ask for your support.
See, I think Senator Britt is indicating he wants much more information on this bill. Senator Britt makes a motion, but Senator Woodard has a question.
Yeah, maybe
or a comment.
Clarifying comment. This just because the appointment authorities, boards, school boards, county commissioners, and now the legislature appoints members of our community college boards, the terms have not lined up. This will essentially put an appointment in each class that comes from each one of those appointing authorities, lines them up and gets those 4-year terms staggered correctly. So there were some questions about it, I think. And so I knew back home people didn't understand. So that was just helpful. And you all did 4 bills to go to match the 4 regions of community college where you found they were unwanted.
That's great.
I should just also, for the record, annotate that the bills that are blocked are Senate Bill 764, Senate Bill 769, Senate Bill 772, and Senate Bill 776. Senator Waddell, do you have a question or a comment?
I do. Yes, concerning, I'm looking at the terms, and I wanted to know, are there any other changes when it comes to those persons who are serving?
Senator Woodard, do you want to answer that?
I don't think so. I mean, it will shorten some terms, lengthen a couple of others. But I think in reviewing this with community college presidents, because I had presidents in a couple of different regions that I talked to, I don't think there was, as Senator Barnes said, I don't think there was any opposition. It just clears things up.
Okay, thank you.
Senator Newton.
I just wanted to reaffirm that it's purely mechanical and it aligns. So after this bill has taken effect, it'll be 3-4-3-4 from there on out. And the person that gets the short term can be reappointed. There's no prohibition against that.
Thank you. Okay, any other questions from the committee? Any member of the public wishing to speak on this bill? These bills? Seeing none, Senator Britt moves for a favorable report as to Senate Bill 764, 769, 772, and 776 as a block vote. All in favor of that motion, please indicate by saying aye. All opposed, no. The ayes have it. The bills pass, and we will be hearing House Bill 10, but we're waiting on the bill sponsor to arrive, so the committee will stand at ease until the bill sponsor is here.
Very interesting. So in the rules of operation of the Senate, if you go to ncleg.gov, you can read further details about what is happening there, and including all of those members. It appeared Senator McGinnis waved his hand around in a circle, which seemed to indicate for him to indicating to the chair to speed up. I've typically seen that gesture in that context. I don't know if that was his intention, but that's my perception. So some of these bills that they just went through as discussed have to do with community colleges, but one of the bills that's coming down the line here, that's one of them. One of the bills that is, I think, in everyone's mind, and certainly I'm very curious about, is House Bill 10, which is an act to require compliance with immigration detainers and administrative warrants to require certain reports from local law enforcement and to authorize the Attorney General to seek a court order for failure to comply. So that's the very, very interesting. There are several sheriffs throughout the state that apparently are not complying already, and they will get into those specifics shortly. And also you can read a summary of that. The chair did indicate that Representative Hall, Jones, Sane, and Smith, I believe they're waiting for them to arrive. So House Bill 10, according to this document, would require that Immigration and Customs Enforcement of the United States Department of Homeland Security, ICE, be queried with an individual charged with certain offenses is in custody and that person's legal residency or United States citizenship status is undetermined. So that means also undocumented folks, is my understanding. It would require a judicial official to order that a prisoner subject to a detainer and administrative warrant be held in custody for 48 hours, excluding Saturday, Sunday, and holidays, or until ICE resolves their request. So that's one question in my mind, is what happens on a Friday if someone is detained? Are they let go for the weekend? What happens then? Create reporting requirements related to ICE queries. Establish a complaint procedure to allow any person to file a complaint with the Attorney General alleging that a jail administrator has failed to comply with these provisions. And it goes on to include more detail. So let's see what lawmakers have to say with today at the NCGA. It appears the video is still going, but the committee is at ease. So I'm always curious what these dynamics look like covering this virtually. So I'm going to just let this play and we will see. It is a very full schedule today, so I do hope that the lawmakers, I'm not sure what's going on with what happened with their delay, but it is a very, very full schedule today. This bill, my understanding is this bill would mandate all North Carolina sheriffs to cooperate with Immigration and Customs Enforcement. It was approved by the Senate Committee on Judiciary yesterday, which positioned the proposal one step closer to it becoming law. It had passed in the House chamber last year.
Would you chair your committee? Thank you, Mr. Chair. We've come to the main event. Okay. House Bill 10 requires sheriffs to cooperate with ICE. Representative Hall, for the record, we're no longer standing at ease. Representative Hall.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Always good to be with you. Members, this bill's come to this committee a number of times as well. You've all heard it debated, so I won't spend a whole lot of time on explaining it, but in a nutshell, about 90 sheriffs in our state right now voluntarily cooperate with ICE in situations where there's an individual here illegally, but not just that. They also have been charged with committing a crime in North Carolina. And the process is they sheriff arrest that person, they go into the jail, they have to do a query to see if that person's a citizen. If not, through that query, they notify ICE, and that's where the issue arises. Because before about 2018, every sheriff in our state, if they arrested somebody, they got the inquiry from ICE that that person had a detainer request, that sheriff would honor that detainer request. And then around 2018, there was a small number of sheriffs who ultimately decided they were no longer going to not only honor detainers, but in many cases, not even communicate at all with ICE. So this bill simply says that when a sheriff who is the in every county is the individual who houses folks who are in a jail, whenever a person is brought into that jail, if they are here illegally, and also, again, they've been charged with a crime in North Carolina at that point, and ICE has also issued a detainer request for that person, the sheriff has to take the individual before a magistrate, and that magistrate would issue pretrial conditions of release, essentially requiring the ICE detainer to be honored. It is essentially a situation that we've seen over and over again. Some of the biggest examples are those in Mecklenburg, where we've had individuals who were charged with crimes. They were then taken to the jail. ICE put out a detainer request on the individual, and the individual met their state law pretrial conditions of release, and they were allowed to leave the jail even though ICE had a detainer request. And the individual goes out and commits another crime. And one of the most well-known examples of that is a situation where an individual within just a matter of a day or so went out and victimized the same domestic violence victim that he had victimized before and was only called after a 9-hour standoff with CMPD. It's at every level law enforcement cooperates with each other in this country, state and federal. And again, it was only until very recently that this became an issue. ICE detainers have been around since the 1950s in this country. And the important thing to keep in mind in this bill is that, you know, just because a sheriff decides that they're not going to cooperate with ICE doesn't mean that all of a sudden federal immigration law just doesn't exist. The folks at ICE are tasked with enforcing the immigration laws in this country. And they still have to do that, whether the sheriff helps them or not in a local, in any given local entity. But what ends up happening is when the sheriff doesn't cooperate, then ICE has to go out into the field. They have to go back to someone's workplace, out to homes to try to go out and serve these ICE detainers. And, you know, we know because, you know, if you talk to any law enforcement officer who's ever been out in the field, probably the most dangerous thing they do is serve a warrant or serve any kind of process. And, you know, as I said in judiciary yesterday, we saw in Charlotte earlier this week, tragic event that had nothing to do with an immigration issue, but they were there serving a warrant. And you never know what you're walking into as a law enforcement officer and serving those warrants. And so when the sheriff doesn't cooperate with an ICE detainer, they necessarily make those folks from ICE have to go out into the field to serve those things. It's not that they're just simply not, they're just going to throw their hands up and say, we're going to, you know, let the detainer go. They're going to have to go out, risk their lives. It's more dangerous for the person that they're taking custody of. It's more dangerous for the folks who are around. And so it's a common sense bill that we shouldn't have to have. Again, before 2018, there was no need for it, but unfortunately, we are where we are at this point. So with that, Mr. Chairman, I'm glad to stand for questions. I hope you all will support the bill.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Members of the committee, do we have questions for the presenter, please? Seeing none, we have requests from the public, six requests. We are going to allow 1.5 minutes for each one of you, and we will start at the top. Let's see. It's hard to read writing here. Grinzelda Onslow, good morning and welcome.
I need interpretation, so that's okay for you?
in town. She had a microphone. Mm-hmm.
No, just,
is our microphone on?
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
La propuesta HB10 trata de mantener seguras a nuestras comunidades y es irónico que su patrocinador principal, el representante Dustin Hall, haya puesto en peligro a conductores en incidentes en la carretera, yendo en un auto conduciendo en estado de ebriedad. Como reportó un medio de comunicación, había alcohol en el auto.
The HB10, it's trying to maintain secure our community, but it's ironic that their sponsors, their main sponsor, Representative Dustin Hall, has put in danger different drivers in different incidents in the drive in the highway, going in a car with a person that was in drunk, as it was reported by one local media. There was alcohol in the car.
Él no manejaba, él tenía responsabilidad directa, pero si hubiera sido un inmigrante indocumentado en esta misma situación, ya estaría en manos de ICE. Me pregunto si el representante Hall siente que sus acciones son para proteger a la comunidad. Mientras el programa 287G estuvo en función en el condado de Wake, más del 80% de personas bajo dicho programa fueron puestas en dicho programa simplemente por una infracción de tránsito. No había alcohol involucrado.
He wasn't driving. He didn't have any responsibility, direct responsibility. But this person would have been an immigrant, undocumented immigrant in the same situation, he would have been in ICE, with ICE. I'm wondering if Representative Hall feels that his actions are to protect the community. In the meantime, Program 287G was in function in Wake County. More than 80% of the people that were processed under each program, it was under just simple infractions of transit infraction. There was no alcohol involved. Thank you.
I would just say, because it was a personal attack, your comments are pathetic to compare somebody being injured in a freak accident to folks who were committing serious felony offenses.
Good morning. I need interpretation too. Okay. Okay. My name is Romelia Salgado and soy una madre inmigrante de Durham. Desde hace 43 años vivo en los Estados Unidos. Me mudé de Texas a Carolina del Norte hace 14 años. Fue aquí donde conocí por primera vez lo que es tener miedo a la policía. Supe lo que eran los retenes y las deportaciones. Vi a trabajadores siendo bajados de sus camionetas de trabajo por ICE. Es doloroso pensar que personas que no han cometido delitos serán arrestados y deportados por no tener documentos. Esto es lo que se convierte. Esto es lo que hará si la HB10 se convierte en ley. Hará que nuestra gente viva en constante temor. Hará que las víctimas no reporten los crímenes y harán que muchos decidamos irnos de este estado por ya no ser un lugar seguro para nuestras familias. El impacto para Carolina del Norte será tremendo porque los inmigrantes aún, cuando los legisladores les cueste reconocerlo, somos productivos, pagamos impuestos, aportamos a la cultura y somos seres humanos con derechos. Hoy, desde como una inmigrante ciudadana estadounidense por naturalización y votante, les pido a los legisladores hacer lo correcto y oponerse a la propuesta H10.
My name is Romelia Salgado and I'm an immigrant mother from Durham. I have lived in the United States for 43 years. I've moved from Texas to North Carolina 14 years ago. It was here in this state that I first learned what it was like to be afraid of the police. I knew what the checkpoints and deportations were like. I saw workers being pulled out of their work vans by office. It is painful to think that people who have not committed a crime will be arrested and deported just because they don't have documents. That's what HB 10 will do if it becomes a law. The impact of North Carolina will be tremendous because of immigrants. Even if it's hard for legislators to recognize it, we're productive, we pay taxes, we contribute to the culture of this state, and we're human beings with rights. So today, as naturalized immigrant, US citizens, and voter, I call on lawmakers to do the right thing and opposed to HB 10.
Thank you. Next, we have Gregorio Morales. Good morning, sir. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
My name is Gregorio Morales. Thank you for listening to me. I've been here for a long time, 20 years. I know some of you because we've been fighting this for a long time. I know Dustin Hall, and I'm going to ask you, where are you coming from, or where are your parents, grandparents coming from? So I am here to represent the Latino community, but also the working people. I am a landscape contractor. I am a job creator. I have how are we gonna get along with my neighbors? How are we gonna trust together? HB10 is completely wrong. Last time they took 60% of the people who they arrested, they got only like a minor violation traffic. So HB10 is wrong. I asked the committee to oppose because we're no longer gonna get along with the neighbors, with you, with the job creators, with the workers. So think twice. Thank you.
Thank you. Next we have Say Alzada. Good morning. Welcome to the committee.
Good morning. My name is Sejal Zota. I am the legal director of Just Futures Law. I have long worked on these issues and argued similar issues before the North Carolina Supreme Court in the Chavez case. First, even though we keep hearing otherwise, let's be clear that this bill impacts large swaths of immigrants and potentially U.S. citizens. In North Carolina, undocumented people generally cannot get driver's licenses. When they are arrested for driving offenses, the data shows that they too are held on detainers. More deportations will happen, and this will impact industry. NPR's data also shows that ICE wrongly detained 1,500 U.S. citizens over a 9-year period, and this bill provides no way to show that you are a U.S. citizen if you are wrongly detained. Second, there are constitutional concerns with ICE detainers and warrants. Federal courts have uniformly held that detainers are just requests, and there is active litigation on the legality of ICE warrants, with the Ninth Circuit saying they may not satisfy the Fourth Amendment because they are not signed by a judge. Federal regulations also make clear that ICE warrants do not give our sheriffs arrest authority. That's why they've asked for an order from the magistrate, but magistrates are not trained in this area, and getting them involved here conflicts with federal law. Lastly, this law opens sheriffs up to financial liability. Several jails around the country have settled lawsuits upwards of hundreds of thousands of dollars where there are class actions, and this law can't insulate our sheriffs. Thank you.
Thank you. Marta Hernandez. Good morning, welcome.
Buenos días, mi nombre es Marta Hernández y soy parte del 10.9% de la fuerza laboral migrante que mueve Carolina del Norte. La HB10 hará que muchos inmigrantes, que mucha fuerza trabajadora se mueva del estado, como ya ha sucedido en otros estados donde estas leyes se han pasado. ¿Por qué quieren sacar del estado a 67,453 dueños de negocios? Esos somos los migrantes, aportamos en esos negocios. ¿Sabían ustedes que el valor de las viviendas cuyos dueños son migrantes asciende a 70,300 millones de dólares? Somos los trabajadores que hemos trabajado en las peores circunstancias. Incluso en la pandemia fuimos nosotros los que mantuvimos moviendo este estado. Mientras ustedes y mucha gente estaba desde su casa recibiendo comida y haciendo su labor desde sus computadoras, nosotros seguimos moviendo Carolina del Norte. Y ahora ustedes nos quieren echar nada más así porque sí. Nosotros también, Carolina del Norte es nuestra casa.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Marta Hernandez, and I'm part of the 10.9% of immigrant labor force that moves North Carolina. The HB10 will make immigrant workers decide to leave the states, and it has already happened in other states where these kind of laws were passed. These laws have made immigrants leave. And if we talk about economic contributions, let me tell you that we're not only a workforce, We're also 67,000 business owners and homeowners that amounts to $70.3 billion. And I could go on with the contributions. We were the ones that kept working during the pandemic when you were stayed at home, working from home and receiving food that we were farming for you. We're here to tell representatives to do the right thing and not to destroy North Carolina, which is also our home.
Thank you, and thank you all for your comment. Members of the committee, for the comments or questions. Thank you. Senator Waddell, good morning, and
you thank have the floor. You. And thank you. As I have listened to some of the testimonies and responses from the public, one of the things, questions that I have when it comes to our large urban and cooperation is, not that there isn't cooperation, but my concern is about the funds. Are there additional funding are provided when you have to keep house the persons who are incarcerated until decisions are made?
Thank you. And that is a question, correct, for the bill sponsored funds.
Thank you, Senator. The answer is there's no funds in the bill because the sheriffs are already doing this. They have been, again, detainers have been around for since about the 1950s and up until 2018, all 100 sheriffs were voluntarily doing it. So it's baked in. You've got probably 90 or so sheriffs who are still doing it right now. The cost would just simply be if there is any additional time that they house an individual, but the max that they would ever do that under this bill would be 48 hours at most. And in talking to ICE and various folks who operate jails, rarely does it take ICE 48 hours to do that. So this is minimal cost in order to keep the public safe.
Thank you. Follow up? Further questions or comments? Seeing none, I'll call for the vote. All of those in favor of... thank you. All those in favor of House Bill 10, require sheriff to cooperate with ICE, please say aye. Aye. Opposed, no. Motion carries. And that concludes the agenda for today's meeting. The meeting is adjourned.
You heard it here today at the NCGA. I'm letting this video play until it stops. I'm curious what the interactions are watching it virtually. I talked about this in other videos, but it's incredibly difficult for people to go physically in person to Raleigh, especially from Western North Carolina. I know many readers, subscribers, supporters of mine have reached out to me saying, asking, you know, what can they do? How can they contact lawmakers? How can they give public comment? So it's a very big challenge. Let's take a brief look at the actual bill language and the history of the vote. So to look up any bill, you can go here to the North Carolina General Assembly's website. On the very top, there is a bill search function, and you can put in the bill number in the corresponding session. So for House Bill 10, if you look back, it states it hasn't been updated because that meeting just wrapped up a minute ago. But if you scroll back down, you'll see on March 28th, 2023, over a year ago, the House voted to pass it, 71 to 44 was the vote. So let's take a brief look at who voted. And interestingly, Brockman and Ray did vote in the affirmative, and no Republicans voted in the negative. So keep that in mind as we go forward and more things develop. From my historical understanding, I will have to fact check, in all due respect to Representative Hall, I don't believe ICE started this in the 1950s, these detainers. I'm going to have to do some more research on that. I'm curious to see when that actually started. But in North Carolina, this has become a rallying call for, as you heard from members of the public, and especially those immigrants and undocumented folks. But of course, you have to couple that with public safety and what the actual law is. Most of these 10 sheriffs are from more urban centers. Of course, Rutherford County is much more rural, and Sheriff James Aaron Ellenberg here has cooperated with ICE, to my knowledge. More to come. Stay tuned. Thanks for watching. Please subscribe and support my work and follow me on social media. See you next time.